Hi everyone, Dr. Colayco here, checking in once again, following up after my first dose of the Moderna COVID-19 vaccine. And I'm also here to address some of the rumors that have been circulating about these vaccines. So first of all, it's been about 5 days since I've received my first dose of the vaccine, and I'm feeling great. So I mentioned to you that in the first 48 hours after receiving the vaccine that I was feeling significant soreness in the arm that I received the vaccine in. And I was also having these waves of fatigue that would hit me around mid-afternoon or so and persist throughout the evenings. So my soreness went away after about 48 hours. So it only lasted for a couple of days. The fatigue lasted a little bit longer for me, maybe about three and a half days after the vaccine. So those are some things to look out for. I mentioned some other what we call systemic side effects, or you know, having more achiness generally in the body. Some people might feel a little bit feverish or develop a low-grade fever or chills as well. And now these systemic side effects of the achiness, the muscle aches, the fever, those tend to be more common with the second dose. We are receiving reports from those who have already gotten their second dose that it is more common to feel these side effects. So again, nothing to be worried about. It's just a sign that your immune system is responding appropriately to the vaccines. So that's the update as far as side effects are concerned. Now I want to start addressing some of the rumors about the vaccines. So one of the more common things that we're hearing about the vaccine is that people feel that the technology is too new. And so they're uncomfortable with taking a vaccine where they feel, oh, it's an mRNA type of vaccine that's new. I'm not familiar with it. So I want to address the mRNA technology specifically. So mRNA technology for vaccines is actually not that new. It's been in clinical trials and in clinical development for nearly 2 decades now, mostly in the area of cancer therapies. Now, the reason that we haven't seen an mRNA vaccine come to market yet is because, unfortunately, they haven't been very effective in treating cancer. However, we did find in the COVID-19 trials that it's very effective against preventing COVID-19 disease. So that's why this happens to be the first vaccine that we see, getting FDA authorization. It happens to be for COVID-19. So hopefully, you know, that helps address some of your questions or concerns about the technology. Now, the other objection or concern that we hear is that people feel that that the development process went too quickly for the COVID-19 vaccines. So I want to address the timeline of the development of these vaccines. There were several factors that contributed to the speediness of this development, you know, and bringing these vaccines, making them available to the public. So one is that as soon as this COVID-19 or the SARS-CoV-2 virus was discovered, the scientists in China who discovered it, they immediately sequenced the DNA or the genome of this virus, and they made that publicly available so that scientists around the world could immediately begin working on developing vaccines against this virus. So because of that international cooperation and that scientific collaboration, that really enabled, you know, the vaccine development process to get started right away. Another thing that helped to make the development process faster is really cutting back more on the bureaucracy of the process, having to do with going through the regulatory process. So there were no shortcuts taken in terms of evaluating the safety or the effectiveness of these vaccines. Where we were able to save time was, you know, here in a normal, under normal circumstances, when companies are developing vaccines, they would run their clinical trials, compile all the data into literally thousands of pages of reports. Then they would submit that to the FDA. Then the FDA would review those thousands of pages of information and then get back to the manufacturers with questions, comments, and then it's a process in terms of getting that approved. So in the case of the COVID-19 vaccines, instead of doing all of those steps, in sequence, one after the other, the manufacturers were conducting these trials and getting information on a daily basis. They would compile that and on a daily basis send that over to the FDA, which the FDA would then review on a daily basis. And so you can see how doing some of these steps in parallel as opposed to in sequence would really cut back on some of the time that's required to get, authorization. Now, the reason that these vaccines were authorized by the FDA in the first place is because the scientists who were evaluating these vaccines for safety and efficacy determined that the potential benefits of this vaccine far outweigh the potential risks of the vaccine, meaning, COVID-19 disease is so serious and so severe. And given the information that came out of these trials, again, these vaccines were studied in tens of thousands of patients. Given that information on the safety and effectiveness, the FDA determined that the benefits outweigh the risks. So I hope that helps clear up, some of the questions or concerns that you might have on the development process. The other piece that also helped make the vaccines available quicker is normally it takes a really long time for the manufacturers to manufacture all of those doses. So again, thinking about the steps, step-by-step process, normally you'd wait for the FDA to say, okay, it's safe and it's effective, and we authorize it to come to market. In this case, the manufacturers actually made their doses ahead of time before knowing whether they would be safe or effective, knowing that if the FDA rejected their vaccine, they would just have to destroy and throw away all those doses. So they manufactured all these millions of doses at risk, meaning at financial risk to themselves, knowing that they might be destroyed. So this really was an international and cooperative effort between multiple countries, multiple companies, and multiple scientists to really make this a reality. So that's on the development process. Another concern that we hear pretty commonly is that a lot of folks might feel that the government has played too much of a role in the development of the vaccines. So I do want to clarify what the role of the government was and is in this whole thing. So the government primarily has played a role in funding the trials. So that means taxpayer dollars, right? We've poured a lot of taxpayer dollars into these vaccines. And the reason is so we can make it available to everybody, no matter, if people can pay for it or not. So the good news is nobody has to pay for these vaccines themselves out of pocket. So you're not going to have to pay a copay or anything like that. You will receive the vaccine free of charge. Nobody's going to charge you for it. And so that requires taxpayer funding. So the government, that was pretty much the government's role, was making sure these things got funded by, public dollars. In terms of, I mentioned the folks who were evaluating the safety and the effectiveness of the vaccine, those included independent committees of scientists, including scientists that were not employed by the pharmaceutical companies or by the government. So you can rest assured that in terms of evaluating whether these vaccines are safe and effective, there were extra layers of external or outside oversight to make sure that everything looked, scientifically sound and robust. So, lastly, we have some questions about what's in the vaccine. So this information is publicly available. If you Google Moderna COVID vaccine fact sheet and Pfizer COVID vaccine fact sheet, you will find in that fact sheet general information on the vaccines, including a list of all the ingredients that are in each of these vaccines. So you'll see that it includes fats, sugars, salts, as well as, of course, the active ingredient, which is the mRNA molecule. So again, mRNA That is the instructions for your muscle cell to create a protein. It's the spike protein, and it looks just like those spiky things on the outside of the coronavirus. So what happens is when you get your vaccine, you're getting the mRNA molecule, your muscle cell is going to take those instructions and make that protein. It's then going to present the protein to your immune system so that your immune system will recognize that spike protein. So if you do get exposed to the COVID-19 virus in the environment, then your immune system will be able to recognize those viruses and attack them and destroy them or kill them. And so that's how it works. Then once your muscle cells make the protein, that mRNA molecule gets destroyed. So your body is not going to hang on to it. It gets destroyed and degraded. So that's how it works. So that's what's in the vaccine. Let me tell you what's not in the vaccine. So the vaccines do not contain any fetal cells. They do not contain any viruses or viral particles. They do not contain preservatives. They have no eggs, and they have no microchips. So the world's tiniest microchip is still too big to fit inside of a needle. But even if it could fit in the needle, it would not go into the COVID-19 vaccines. So rest assured, none of those things are in the vaccines. So I hope that's helpful to you. Hope it helps clarify some questions or concerns that you might have. And remember that every medical decision is a balance between the risks versus the benefits. And we know how severe COVID-19 disease can be. It can send you to the hospital, to the ICU. It causes deaths. We've seen so many deaths already. And, you know, even for survivors of COVID-19 disease, for some people, they still have long-lasting health effects from that virus. Some people are experiencing chronic fatigue. Some people have experienced heart damage and brain damage. And we have yet to see what that looks like over the long run, you know, over several years. And so, you know, the risk of serious illness and complications from COVID-19 disease far, far outweigh the potential risks from the vaccine itself. Again, we've seen this vaccine studied in tens of thousands of patients in the clinical trials. And with every day that goes by, more and more people are taking this vaccine. We're going to see it in millions of people and have more information on it. But for me personally, I'll take a couple of days of feeling tired or maybe even achy or feverish over risking getting the actual disease itself. So I hope that was helpful information for you to make an informed decision for yourself on whether you would like to take this vaccine. And it is a very safe and very effective tool in our toolbox to really end this pandemic once and for all. Thank you.